Well, this morning we are in the book of Matthew, the 8th chapter, picking up kind of where we left off last week. As in last week, we were in the earlier part of the 8th chapter of Matthew, and then today we're picking up here, but also picking up on the theme that we have been focusing in on for the last several weeks about this idea of the word go. Simple two-letter word, very short word that appears often in our scriptures, around 1,500 times, actually, in our scriptures. But it is a word that comes with responsibility. It is a word that comes with this hinge of instruction from God into our lives and then a follow-through on our behalf or something of that nature. And here in the Gospel of Matthew, the 8th chapter, we come to this moment where there is this transition that takes place. And there is this moment of transition. I kind of pointed out last week as we were looking at the story of the centurion and the healing that took place of his servant, how that was the middle of three stories that Matthew told consecutively of Jesus healing and bringing that healing power and demonstrating it for the world. So these three miracles of healing that took place. And now Matthew, he transitions, and this is the first of three stories of Christ's power over the miracle of power over forces of nature or over evil spirits or over sin itself. And so the next three miracles that we see of Christ are these miracles of power where Jesus is demonstrating his great power. But before we launch into that actual moment where Jesus has power over the storm and over the sea and everything that takes place there, there are these words buried in Matthew chapter 8, beginning in verse 18, that at first glance, they almost seem a little harsh. There are these moments where two individuals, they come to Jesus after his teaching and they approach Jesus with a request to follow after him. And Jesus' response to them seems a little harsh at first glance. But I don't think that Jesus was trying to be harsh as much as he was trying to point out the reality of what it is to follow him. And so let's take a look at those verses just for a moment together. In Matthew chapter 8, beginning in verse 18, we read these words, "When Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to go over to the other side of the lake. Then a teacher of the law came to him and said, 'Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go.' Jesus replied, 'Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head.' Another disciple came and said, 'Lord, first let me go and bury my father.' And Jesus told him, 'Follow me and let the dead bury their own dead.' And then he got into the boat, and his disciples followed him." Father God, I pray that as we look at these words, that you would open them to us through your Holy Spirit, that Spirit you would speak to our hearts, our minds, our souls, that we would glean from you your truth. And any other things that we bring to the table, our pre-notions, our understandings, God, that we would lay them aside to see your truth in our life. God, that we would take your scripture, your word, and apply it. God, that we would make it the most important thing at this moment, that your word meeting with you would trump everything else. And so, God, I just thank you. I praise you that you have given us your spirit to live in us, to open your word to us, to give us that truth. And so, God, may we worship you with all of who we are as we continue in this word, and may we surrender it to you, and may we hear from you and you alone. So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O God. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. I want to start off with a question for you guys. We kind of looked at a small question last week, but today I want to just take a look at a different question. And that question is simply this: where do you follow Christ? That seems like a question that should have an easy answer. It seems like a question that should make a lot of sense. It would be a quick answer. Where do I follow Christ? I follow Christ anywhere he leads. I go wherever he wants me to go. would seem like the right answer. But the problem is that it's not often. I'm having some microphone issues up here. I don't know if you guys are getting that back there. Sorry. That's not often the way that we operate. Often we go through our everyday doing our own thing, our everyday life, hoping that Jesus will tag along like a good friend or maybe even a lost puppy, that Jesus would just go with us wherever we go, rather than realizing that we need to follow him. And instead, we think that asking God to follow us into our world and into our workplace and into our agenda is the same as following him. But it's not. It's not the same. Or maybe we view relationship with Jesus as maybe a little more like having an acquired personality trait, that the longer we are in relationship with Christ, the more he changes our personality. And so then we hope that that personality trait amongst us goes with us wherever we may go and that others would see it. But neither the idea of taking Christ wherever we go or changing our personality type to be more like his, and don't get me wrong, being like Christ is important, none of those really capture the idea of following Christ. In verse 18 of this passage of Scripture, Jesus initiates a call to his disciples to follow him. It seems simple. He is teaching. He has been teaching. He teached the Sermon on the Mount, and many people were there, and then he left that location, and he went to Caesarea, and he taught there, and there was a great amount of people that were gathering where Jesus was. Maybe they were gathering to hear exactly what he had to say. Maybe they were gathering because they had heard what he was doing. I mean, after all, he had healed sick people. He had raised people up. He had done some pretty miraculous and powerful things. And so for whatever reason, there was a crowd gathered on this particular day. And Jesus, he sees the crowd around him. And like the good Savior, the good Messiah that he is, he desires to stay where the crowd is, right? Actually, that's not what we read. This passage of Scripture is full of surprises. He sees the crowd around him and the great multitude of people, the King of Kings, the one who has come to save the people. He sees this big crowd and he says, "Hey guys, it's time to get in a boat and leave the crowd." Now, we don't know exactly why in this instance he chose to leave the crowd and go to another location. It's not for us to determine God's plan, but that is exactly what happened. He left the crowd, who seemed like they were interested in knowing what he had to say. He left the crowd, he gets in a boat, he tells his disciples it's time to go to the other side of the lake. And in so doing, when he is saying, "I'm going to depart from this group of people and go to another place where I have something else that's going to happen," and don't get me wrong, Jesus' ministry continues on and it does some pretty amazing things, but when he separates from that crowd for that moment and goes somewhere else, it triggers a response by at least two individuals. The first one we find in verse 19 is a teacher of the law. This teacher of the law comes to Jesus before he can push off from the shore and get out into the water. He comes to Jesus and he says, "Teacher," or "Rabbi, I will follow you wherever you may go." That sounds like a great proclamation by this individual. And Jesus responds to him in verse 20. And then in verse 21, a second individual comes. The first one was a teacher of the law. The second one is described as a disciple or a follower of his. Not one of the 12, mind you, but someone who was there and had been a part of his teaching and was really interested in what God had to say or what Christ had to say. And he says to Jesus in verse 21, "Lord, I would like to go and bury my father, and then I will come and follow you." And Jesus responds to him. And when we look at those verses, and we look at what Jesus had to say to them, it almost seems harsh. Because after all, didn't Jesus just say to his disciples, "Let's get in the boat, let's go"? And these two individuals are saying, "We'll follow you." And Jesus, it would seem, turns them away. That's what it would seem like. But understand there's a couple of things here. First of all, Jesus doesn't turn them away at all. He just gives them truth. And what they do with the truth is them walking away. That was their choice. He just proclaims to them what the reality of the situation is. And then they could choose to do with it what they wanted to. And in these two individuals and the truth that Jesus presents them and what would be the inherent reaction from them to this truth is something that humanity wrestles with all of the time. We are like these two men. We have this opportunity to follow Christ. And as we have this opportunity to follow Christ, I want to encourage you to not just see it on the surface, but to see all that Christ is wanting when he says, come and follow after me. You see, this isn't the first time that Jesus has told his disciples to follow him. This isn't the first time where he says, I'm going to go to a certain location and I want you guys to come along. Matter of fact, at the very beginning of his earthly ministry, he starts off by calling the disciples to come and follow him. He is literally asking them to leave everything behind and follow him. Leave their family behind, follow him. Leave their vocation behind, follow him. Leave everything that is in their known world, their securities, their plans, their ambitions, all of it, leave it behind and follow him. And many, many times when we read about Jesus calling his disciples, earlier in the book of Matthew, also in some of the other Gospels, when we read about Jesus calling his disciples, what we oftentimes read is that there is this word that is there that is immediately. Like when he called Peter and James and John to lay down their nets, they immediately followed Jesus to become fishers of men. When he asks Matthew, the tax collector, to come and follow and become my disciple, he immediately leaves that situation and goes and he follows Jesus. In this situation, in Matthew chapter 8, verse 18, he has seen this large crowd around him, and he determines that it is time to go to the other side. He declares it to his disciples. He gives orders to get the boat ready, to get everything in order, to cross over to the other side. They don't know why. They don't know the purpose. And some are ready to follow the two. And here is the truth about those two. They almost are opposite types in so many ways, and yet so many ways they encompass what you and I in our faith journey experience. They are opposites. One is too swift with his decisions. The other is too slow to make a decisive step. In the beginning here, Jesus, he starts to treat them according to their weaknesses. This rashness or this sluggishness. And so he represses the one who is too spontaneous. At the same time, he stimulates the one who is too reserved. In our faith journey, we come to those moments where God wants to give us the truth of the situation, of what it looks like to follow him. This isn't the first, and it is not the last time in all of Scripture where God does that with individuals. But what we see in this passage of Scripture is this calling that Jesus, this initial calling of Jesus for his disciples to go and get in a boat and cross. And then there are these other things that come up. And then he caps it all off in verse 23. Matthew caps it all off, and he says very simply this statement. Then he got into the boat, that is Jesus, and his disciples followed him. And so let me go back to that question just for a moment. Where do you follow Christ? When do you follow Christ? How do you follow Christ? You see, I do think that many times it's easy for us to get caught in the idea of just let me live my life, and God, you come along on that journey. But God wants to be the one in charge of how we live that life, where we go, instead of just being the person riding shotgun. And so when we see these two individuals, oftentimes we can see ourselves. I know for me, I can definitely see myself. There have been moments in my life where I have been like the first individual, and I have acted with maybe some unconsidered commitment. You know, this commitment to God where I will, you know, I am all in, which sounds great. and it really is great, but I haven't yet weighed the cost. And to that individual, Jesus just simply says, that's great, you want to follow me, pause. Here's what following me looks like. And he gives an illustration. Even foxes have holes and birds have nests, but if you're going to follow me, there is no place that you'll be able to call home, is basically what he's saying. And in truthfulness, in our own world, that is still the case. If we are truly Christ followers, if we are truly committed to all that he is and all that he says for our lives, and if we want to follow him everywhere, we are not at home in this world. We may have a home in this world, don't get me wrong, but we should not be at home in this world. We should be different than the world around us. I want to pause for just a moment and take a look at this person with unconsidered commitment just for a minute. The scripture doesn't tell us a lot about the individual. It doesn't give us a name. It doesn't tell us anything more than just a title. It tells us in some translations that he is a scribe. In other translations, it's translated as a teacher of the law. Either way, this is an individual who works for the church. This is an individual who is considered holy. This is an individual who is considered to have knowledge of who God is. This is an individual who knows the scripture in and out because they spend their life in it. This is a person everyone else looks up to and says, they get it. They get it. That whole relationship with God, they get it. And yet they're wanting more. And they come to Jesus and they lay it all out there saying, I will follow you anywhere. Everywhere. It doesn't matter. I'll go with you anywhere you go. And Jesus doesn't turn them away. He just simply says, oh, really? Because here's what it looks like. You won't have a home. You won't have a place to lay your head. You will not be at home in this world any longer. Now, a little cultural thing we need to understand. First of all, in biblical times in the Holy Land, specifically, the more important people tended to be people who worked for the church. They were the ones who had more wealth, more prestige in the community. They were the ones who had the finer garments as dictated by the Old Testament. They were the ones who were to look a certain way, act a certain way. They were looked up to and all of these things. And this young man, old man, doesn't matter. This guy, he comes before Jesus probably dressed well, probably having lived a luxury lifestyle according to that day and age's standard. And he comes to Jesus and he says, I will follow you anywhere. And Jesus just simply says, that's great. It looks like giving up everything. It reminds me of another passage of scripture where a rich young ruler comes to Jesus. And Jesus looks at him and says, you know, you must obey the law, the Ten Commandments. And the young man says, I have done that. And Jesus says, one more thing, you need to sell what you have and give it to the poor. It reminds me a little bit of that. Or maybe it also reminds me of Luke chapter 9, verse 23, where Jesus, in another setting, a different location, he is teaching his disciples, those 12 amongst him, and another bit that are gathered in the crowd at that day, and he is teaching them what, again, it is to be a servant of God or to follow him. He says these words in verse 23 of chapter 9 of Luke. He says, you must daily deny yourself. You must take up a cross in order to follow me. You see, Jesus, as he is telling them to go to the other side, as he is giving them instructions to move on, he is wanting them to understand that when we move on in relationship with God, it is this moving on of giving all of who we are before him. And he doesn't want us to just blurt it out and not mean it. That is the lesson I see with this first individual. Is Jesus wants this first individual, before he says, I will follow you anywhere, he wants him to say and to understand, listen, that's great that you say that, but this is what it means to follow me. It means that you do not have a home in this world any longer. It means that you look differently than you do right now. It means that you will not stand out in the way that you do now. Instead, you will stand out for being so very different than the world around you. And in our lives, we have that same call on God when he says, hey, get in the boat, we're going to go to the other side. Jesus is saying, I'm giving you this call to follow me, and I'm not going to turn you away, but I want you to understand what that means. In your community, you are to look a little different maybe than everyone else. You are to act a little differently than everyone else. And Jesus, he was really good at giving more specifics than that. He doesn't just say, hey, look differently, so instead of, you know, dressing up, you dress down or whatever, as we have oftentimes made it seem in the church. But rather, Jesus didn't care about physical appearance. That's not what he meant when he said, you need to look differently. He says to his disciples over and again, if you're going to really follow me, you need to become a servant to everybody. You need to become the person who's satisfied to come in last place so that somebody else can come in first place. You need to be someone who is willing to love others no matter what they've done to you. You need to be willing to stand out and be different because you are a person filled with grace instead of a person filled with your rights. He says to us that you are a person that needs to walk in faith of who I am instead of trying to figure it out on your own. He wants us to look differently. He wants us to consider the cost. He wants us to know just what it is to follow him, and to follow him means that we deny ourselves, that we take up a cross, we die out to self to follow him. Paul says it this way in Romans chapter 12. He says that we would be living sacrifices, that we would allow Christ to live in us by putting to death the selfish nature that is Stephen Moit, or your own name. And this first disciple, this first teacher of the law, this first individual seeing that Jesus is wanting to go somewhere else, he says very clearly, I want to go with you. And then Jesus lays it out there and says, okay, here's what that looks like. Now, sadly, when Jesus laid it out there and said, okay, here's what that looks like, we read nothing more of that individual. I have a feeling that if he had said, okay, I'm good with that, that maybe Matthew would have indicated that. Instead, we read nothing more of that individual. It implies that he did not get in the boat with them. He was not one of them in verse 23 that gets in the boat and follows after Christ. And then that second individual I have related to as well at other parts in my life. And whereas the first one had this unconsidered commitment to God, he didn't consider the commitment, he just blurted it out there, and I have done that. This other one had the avoidance of commitment, where they really wanted to follow God, but I need to do this first. I need to take care of this. I need everything to look perfect. I need everything to work out the way that it's supposed to. I need to have assurances from you, God, that if I follow you, then everything will be taken care of. I need to have assurances from you that if I call myself a Christ follower, that I'll still be able to take care of my family, that I'll still have comfort, that I'll still have. And it seems like a valid reason at first that he wants to stay behind. Christ, I will follow you. Send me an email, tell me where you're going to be in 3 months from now, because right now I need to take care of some stuff with my family. He even mentions death. I need to bury my father. Which sounds like, in today's culture, how in the world could Jesus say, no, you can't even attend your dad's funeral? But that's not actually what he's saying here. If you actually look at Scripture in its context, in the original language, the man's dad wasn't dead yet. What the guy was actually saying is, Jesus, I want to follow you, but I need to stay home until my dad dies. Maybe he was the firstborn son and he was the one in charge according to that patriarchal culture that he lived in. I don't know. But what he was really saying is, I will stay here and take care of my family. And then when it's convenient, God, then I will come and meet up with you and I will follow you from there. We do that in our relationship with God sometimes. We get in that idea of needing to know that all of the answers are spelled out. We get into that idea of laying stipulations out there to God. God, I will follow you anywhere. I will do whatever you want me to do as long as you don't ask me to go and talk to this person. As long as you don't want me to do this, and or we have other things. God, I'm going to follow you someday, but right now I've got to take care of this in my life. Or God, I want to be fully committed to you, and I want to be your disciple that goes where you go, but right now I have this responsibility, and it has to take it has to be taken care of. What we are saying to God when we do that is, I like the idea of you, God, but this is more important. My life is more important than following you. Now, we would never say that to God, but that's what our actions are saying. That's what many times we are saying by what we do. We are saying, God, it is a great idea to follow you. It is a great idea to be one of your disciples, to get in a boat. But I have these other things that need to take place. It would also seem at the very outset of this person who has this avoidance of this commitment to God that he would be a devoted follower. He is described in his introduction not by a name or an occupation as many times in other scriptures people are, but just like the first person, he is described rather with a title of disciple or devoted follower, someone who is already been listening to Jesus' teaching, has already consumed some of what Jesus had to say. Maybe he was there on the mountainside, heard the Sermon on the Mount, thought, you know, these Beatitudes are pretty good. I want to follow this guy. But first, I need to take care of my family. And just so he knows I'm committed to him, I'm going to go tell him that I'm going to follow him. But first, I need to take care of this stuff here. He'll understand that, right? And we live our lives that way. We maybe hide amongst the crowd of the church. We attend. We think the idea of Jesus is a good idea. We maybe even participate in certain activities or ministries, and we think that we are really following God. But many times we are actually putting other things as more important than him. More important than listening when he says, hey, it's time to go. I know things are comfortable here. We've got a good crowd. Everything's happening. Everything's going well. Verse 18, Stephen Moy paraphrase, but it's time to go. We don't understand when Jesus says in the middle of the good moments, it's time to move on. We don't understand when Jesus looks at what would be earthly success and says, we need to get in a boat. And by the way, when we're in this boat, you're going to encounter a massive storm. It's going to be great. And you're going to find out just how powerful I really am as you fear for your life. Right? We don't look at God and say, ooh, sign me up. We would rather know that we will get safely to the other side. We would rather know that it's all worked out. We would rather know that we can still have some of our creature comforts and we can still dictate our own path and our own plan. And here's the thing. What that is making those things, our path, our plan, In essence, the word our, more important than God. More important than relationship with God. More important than following him. You see, in verse 18, Jesus initiates a call to all true disciples of his that are there in that place to go to the other side. And in verse 23, we find the follow-up of those who do just that. They get in the boat, Jesus gets in the boat, and his disciples follow him. So let me go back to that question that I started with. Let me change it just a little bit. And let me ask this question instead. Are you following Jesus? Or are you waiting for Jesus to follow you? Are you wanting Jesus to follow you? Are you following his plan, his path, his purpose for your life? Or are you just asking him to accompany you along on your journey, to your ends, to your means, with your comfort still intact? How are you following God? When are you following God? In this passage of Scripture, It is this introduction from Jesus to say, I do want you to follow me. It's time to get in the boat. Jesus knew full well the storm was coming. Jesus knew full well that they would fear for their very lives. Jesus knew full well that it was actually just the start. It was just the tip of the iceberg of all of the storm that they would face throughout their lives. Every one of the 12 disciples would give their life, either being martyred or exiled, to follow Christ. They weren't strong enough yet, but he wanted them to follow him so that they could grow on the journey. He wants you, he wants me to follow him so that we can grow on the journey. But are we willing to say, you know what? I know it's going to cost me, and I'm still all in. Are we willing to say, it doesn't matter where you take me, it doesn't matter when you take me, I'm still all in? Because that's what God wants for you. That's what God wants for me, is that we would be his followers in every moment. Not just when it's convenient, not just when everything's going good, but that we would follow him. Call of Jesus for his disciples to follow him into the boat, in verse 18, is the same call that Christ has for you and I today. The band's going to come and they're going to close us in worship. And as they do so, I want to just pray with us this morning. God, you are a great and loving God. You care so much for this world. You care so much for the individuals in this world that you gave your life while we were still sinners so that we could have forgiveness of sins. You cared for us so much that you overlook our weaknesses, you overlook our inabilities, and instead you fill us with the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit. You love us so much that you ask us to get in a boat and follow you, knowing, God, that it will make us stronger. You promised us you will never leave us and never forsake us, and we hold on to that. You never promised us that we would always be comfortable and that life would always be good. But God, we trust you in that boat. We trust you in that storm. We trust you that you have a purpose and you have a plan and you have a reason that you ask us to go and follow. And so God, as we lay our lives before you, God, help it to be unreserved to you. God, that we would count the cost and know exactly what it is to follow you and still say, I'm all in, Jesus. I'm all in. Whatever it is that you would have of me, wherever it is you would have me go, whatever you would want me to say, whomever you want me to serve and be around, God, I am all in. And God, I thank you that when we make that commitment to you, when we declare in all truthfulness that we will follow you in that level, God, you fill us with your Spirit and you enable us to do just that. And so, God, I thank you and I praise you. In Jesus' name I pray.